Good morning, students. In the previous classes, we discussed the Thomson model and also alpha particle experiment and what are the observations from the experiment and what are conclusions from the experiment we discussed. And from that experiment, how Rutherford proposed his model, what are the postulates and what are the drawbacks we discussed in the previous class. And also some derivations I have given. Distance of the closest approach and also how it depends upon the various parameters like kinetic energy, momentum, velocity and potential difference I have given, and also what is impact parameter, how we can find the shape of the trajectory of the alpha particle in experiment we have given, and one more, how many alpha particles are scattered with an angle theta also we discussed. And on what factors number of alpha particles scattered depends also we have given, and one or two sums numericals also we solved. In today class, by using a Rutherford model, how we can derive an expression for total energy of electron in the circular orbit and what is the radius of the circular orbit, what is the speed of electron, we'll calculate from Rutherford model. So in the previous class already mentioned, electron, the central part of the atom where the total positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom concentrated is called as the nucleus. So the central part or core of the atom is called as a nucleus. It is a nucleus having a positive charge and atomic number of this nucleus is called Z. So generally if take one name of the element is called X. Always atomic number represents Z, which is equal number of protons and also number of electrons. A is equal to mass number, which indicates sum of the protons plus neutrons. If one nucleus contains Z protons, charge of one proton is equal to plus E, then Z protons equal to write ZE. So the charge of the given nucleus we can write plus ZE. And one electron having a mass is equal to M. Mass of electron M and charge of electron is equal to E is revolving around the nucleus in circular orbit like this. Now the radius of the circular orbit I'll take R. So the central part to the circular orbit I'm taking a radius which is equal to small r, and the velocity of electron in this orbit is equal to V. Now the electron is revolving around the nucleus in a circular orbit of radius R with a velocity V. Mass of electron M and charge of electron is equal to E. Now what is the radius of this circular orbit, we'll derive an expression. What is the velocity of electron in that orbit, we'll discuss. Because of the motion of electron, there is some energy which is called kinetic energy. Also we'll derive the formula for kinetic energy and also electrostatic P. By adding the P and K, you will get total energy of electron. But one important note you have to remember, why the electron is revolving in the circular orbit means there is a reason. One necessary force is required. What is that force? Centripetal force. Any electron revolving in the circular orbit means there is a necessity of the centripetal force, which is provided by the electrostatic force between the nucleus and electron. So that also given by Rutherford model. Now I'll write the formula. When electron, mass of electron, we can write here mass of electron. Mass of electron is equal to M. Next, velocity of electron or speed of electron. Velocity of electron or speed of electron is equal to V. And charge. So charge of electron, I'll take it is equal to Q1. Or it is equal to Q2, I'll take, which is equal to E. And the charge of the given nucleus. So charge of the given nucleus, I'll take, it is equal to Q1, which is equal to ZE. Charge of the nucleus is equal to ZE, and the charge of the electron is equal to E. Now radius of the given circular orbit is equal to R. Radius of the circular orbit where the electron is revolving is equal to R, you should write. So these are the important letters. Now, when electron revolving in the circular path, so the necessary force is nothing but a centripetal force. Centripetal force is required for the circular motion of electron. But this centripetal force is provided by electrostatic force between the nucleus and electron. So which is equal to electrostatic force. I'll equate both. Equal to electrostatic force between the nucleus and electron. Whenever both are equal, then only electron can revolve in that orbit. Now we know centripetal force formula mv square by r. In the first PUC we know this formula, where m is equal to mass of electron, v speed of electron, r radius of the circular orbit. So centripetal force is equal to mv square by r. Now what is the electrostatic force means? According to Coulomb's inverse square law, electrostatic force formula 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, it is a constant value, into charge of the first one, first means nucleus q1, charge of the electron I am writing of q2, divided by square of the distance equal to r square. It is similar to in a first PUC we have gravitation chapter. If a two bodies are separated by certain distance, what is the gravitational force between these two bodies means F is equal to G M1 M2 by R square formula given. Similar model, instead of the two bodies I have selected two charged particles. One is the nucleus, one is electron, and both separated by a distance R. What is electrostatic force between these two particles means it is equal to G place we have to write 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. M1 M2 place I am writing Q1 Q2 charges by distance equal R square. But already I have given Q1 is equal to charge of the nucleus ZE, we have to substitute here. Q2 is equal to charge of electron E, we have to substitute here. Therefore mv square by R is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 is equal to ZE and Q2 is equal to E divided by R square you should write. So both sides if you want to cancel one R, here R square R, here R left side R will be cancelled. Therefore mv square is equal to ZE into E is equal to ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught into R you should write. So from this formula we may calculate radius of the orbit and also speed of electron. Anyone may calculate from this formula. So if you want to calculate the radius of the orbit, first one, radius of the circular orbit I want to calculate. Radius of the circular orbit where the electron is revolving, if you want to calculate, check the formula. R is equal to, take this letter R left side and mv square right side, then what will get? R is equal to ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught into mv square. So mv square taken right side and this R taken left side. It is a formula for radius of the circular orbit of an electron which is revolving around the nucleus of any atom. For example, if it is a particularly hydrogen atom, then so we know atomic number of the hydrogen is equal to Z. For a hydrogen atom, for a hydrogen atom, atomic number Z is equal to 1. If you substitute in the above formula, check what will get. Radius of the circular orbit R is equal to E square, because Z place we can write E, that is equal to E square by 4 pi epsilon naught into mv square. It is a only for radius of a circular orbit of a hydrogen atom where the electron is revolving. So it is a formula for radius. Similar model, if you want to find the velocity of electron or speed of electron, what is the formula for speed of electron in the given circular orbit? So how to find the magnitude of the velocity is also called speed of electron. How to find the speed? In this formula, take m right side and take a square. So that is a v square is equal to ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught into m r. So this m value taken right side, and if you remove this square, we'll get a root. Therefore, speed of electron v is equal to root z e square. You should write that equal to square root of z e square by 4 pi epsilon naught into m r. We can write it is a formula for speed of electron in the given circular orbit of any atom, not particularly hydrogen. So here also, if you want to write a formula for a hydrogen atom, we have to substitute z is equal to 1. So I'll write here for a hydrogen atom. For hydrogen atom, put the atomic number z is equal to 1. For a hydrogen atom, z is equal to 1. If you substitute, then check what will get. V is equal to, no need to write z because z is equal to 1. Root e square, root 2 square will be cancelled. We can take outside also. Therefore, E divided by square root of 4 pi epsilon naught into m r. Check carefully. In this formula, in place of the z, I am writing a 1. So no need to write z. But e square is there in the numerator. Root e square is equal to e. And but denominator, we should write root as it is. 4 pi epsilon naught into m r. So it is a radius of the circular orbit of an atom, and it is where the electron is revolving. It is a formula for speed of electron in a given circular orbit where the electron is revolving. And one more also may calculate, because of the motion of electron, there is some energy called kinetic energy. So we can calculate kinetic energy of electron also. Next one, third one, what is the formula for kinetic energy of electron? So kinetic energy of electron will calculate. Third one, kinetic energy of an electron where it is revolving. Kinetic energy of electron. So I'll use the symbol KE or E suffix K. Anyone may write. So what is the reason for kinetic energy? Means only because of the motion of electron in the given circular orbit, there is a kinetic energy. So we know formula for kinetic energy, K is equal to half mv square. So kinetic energy formula, K is equal to half m into v square. But already I obtained formula for mv square. Mv square is equal to formula z e square by 4 pi epsilon naught into r. So this value as is, I'll substitute in this formula. Therefore, half into mv square plus, I am writing this formula, z e square divided by 4 pi epsilon naught into r, which is equal to z e square by 2 into 4, 8 pi epsilon naught into r. So it is the formula for kinetic energy of electron. So I will write this one as equation 1. Kinetic energy of electron in given circular orbit of any atom. If it is a particularly asked hydrogen atom, so no need to write z. Simply write K is equal to E square by 8 pi epsilon naught into r. In the same way, electrostatic potential energy, I'll calculate. Electrostatic PE, fourth one. Electrostatic potential energy. Electrostatic potential energy. It is not a gravitational PE. We are calculating electrostatic PE. We are finding a electrostatic PE of electron. But whenever electron is revolving around the nucleus, so nucleus having a positive charge, and electron is a negatively charged particle. So because of this electrostatic force of attraction, so there is some configuration or state, and because of this configuration or state, it has some electrostatic PE, and I'll calculate this one. So we know the formula electrostatic PE. In the previous class also I used this formula, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into charge of the nucleus of Q1 into charge of the electron Q2 divided by R. If you write R square, it is nothing but coulomb's inverse square law, force of attraction. But only for it are, it is a formula for electrostatic PE. But already we know Q1, Q2 values. Here, I'll write a charge of the nucleus. So Q1 is equal to plus ZE. So because nucleus contains Z protons, charge of one proton is equal to plus E and Z proton is equal to plus ZE. Similar model, charge of electron Q2 is equal to minus E. Here, in case of the potential energy formula, we need to substitute negative sign of electron also, because the negative sign always indicates electron is attracted by the nucleus, or electron is bounded to the nucleus. If you want to remove the electron, something energy has to be supplied. That's why I am using a negative sign also. So the negative sign always indicates electron is attracted by the nucleus. Now substitute both the values in the above formula. PE is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 is equal to plus ZE and Q2 is equal to minus E divided by radius of the orbit is equal to R. Radius of the circular orbit is equal to R, I should write. Now PE is equal to, so ZE into minus E is equal to minus ZE square divided by 4 pi epsilon naught into R, that is equal to second equation. Observe the formula carefully. First and second equation. So first equation we calculated, or we derived the formula for KE, and the second equation we derived the formula for PE. But both are almost the same. Here negative sign is there, here negative sign not there. Here negative sign always indicates electron is bound to the nucleus, electron is attracted by the nucleus. But here 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, here 8 is there. And if you write this value, 1 by 2 into 4, if you write this value, half into this total value we can write. That's all. Now if you add first and second equations, we'll get the total energy of electron. That is the fifth one. For adding a total energy of electron. Total energy of electron. Add first and second equations. Total energy of electron. Fifth one. Total energy of electron in the given circular orbit. Total energy of electron. So we can represent symbol as E. So total energy E is equal to formula, the sum of kinetic energy and the potential energy, adding the first and second equations. Already I have given, substitute the first equation there. KE place you have to write ZE square by 8 pi epsilon naught into R plus, next PE place you have to write minus ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught into R. Minus ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught into R, I should write. So we take common also here. ZE square common. And 4 pi epsilon naught R also we can write outside complete. If write here, it is equal to ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught into R common remaining. Here still we have 1 by 2 is there. 1 by 2 plus into minus minus 1. 1 by 2 minus 1. 1 by 2 minus 1 is equal to minus 1 by 2. So this value minus 1 by 2. If you simplify here, minus ZE square by 2 into 4 is equal again 8 pi epsilon naught into R. It is a formula for total energy of electron in an atom. Total energy of electron in the given circular orbit of an atom. If it is a hydrogen atom given, put Z is equal to 1. In case of for a hydrogen atom, if electron is revolving in the hydrogen atom, because we are selecting a, why hydrogen atom only means it is one of the simplest atom which contains only a single electron. That's why easy to apply the formula. For a hydrogen atom, if you write Z is equal to 1, in the above formula, E is equal to minus E square by 8 pi epsilon naught into R. So it is a formula for total energy of electron, kinetic energy of electron, potential energy of electron, radius of the circular orbit, and also speed of electron in the given orbit. But last to this minus, what does it represents? Electron is bound to the nucleus. If you want to note down that point, in the above expression, the negative sign represents, the negative sign represents that the electron is bound to the nucleus. Electron is bound to the nucleus. The word bound represents attracted by the nucleus. So bound meaning attracted by the nucleus, should write. So electron is bound to the nucleus. So these are the important expressions by using Rutherford model. So you have to understand carefully, in a final exam, if they ask a question, derive an expression for total energy of electron in an atom by using a Rutherford model. So only we have to derive this formula, total energy formula, how to derive. So sometimes they may not mention the word Rutherford. So in this same chapter, later after Bohr's model also will derive the formula for total energy. So in case of the Bohr's model, means they may give the question, derive an expression for total energy of electron in the stationary orbit of hydrogen atom. So in case of the Bohr's model, there is a new word, stationary orbit. But in the Rutherford model, there is no stationary orbit. They may ask only, derive an expression for total energy of electron will be asked. So then we have to derive only by using the Rutherford model. If they used the word stationary orbit, we have to go for Bohr's model. So that is important. So with this total Rutherford model concept completed, so by the end of the Rutherford's model, what are the major drawbacks? Means Rutherford model unable to explain stability of the atom. So whether the atom is stable or not explained by Rutherford model, one drawback. Second drawback, how the electrons are fixed in the various orbits, or how electrons are arranged in the atom, also not explained. Second drawback. One more drawback, what is the nature of the spectral lines or spectrum produced by hydrogen atom and also other atoms, not explained by Rutherford model. They are the major drawbacks. So to rectify these drawbacks, next model proposed by the scientist Niels Bohr in 1913. So we'll discuss next concept, Bohr's model, Bohr's atom model, or Bohr's model of atom. But actually, earlier scientists, Thomson or Rutherford, they explained the nature of the atom and also structure of the atom by applying classical mechanics and also electromagnetism. So generally, classical mechanics already mentioned in a dual nature of matter and radiation. So classical mechanics generally we can apply to the macroscopic bodies, like whenever car moving along a straight line, or whenever a person moving on a bicycle, or if take a duster, or any macroscopic bodies are given, we can apply classical mechanics only to the bigger bodies or macroscopic bodies. And we cannot apply classical mechanics to smaller particles like electrons or protons or neutrons. It is quite difficult to apply the classical mechanics. That's why. So Bohr given a new theory or new model, which is called Bohr's model of atom. And what are the main postulates of the Bohr's model? Right, postulates. So here also there are some drawbacks, but what are the major postulates? Means so Bohr important four postulates are given. So first one, so generally according to Thomson or according to Rutherford, whatever may consider, what is the shape of the atom? Spherical. So atom is a spherical with a size 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. And by the end of the Rutherford model, we know one thing, nucleus. What is the nucleus means? The central part of the atom where the total positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom concentrated is called nucleus. So that is also given by Bohr's model. So we can write the first one fastly. The central part of the atom where the total positive charge, central part of the atom where the total positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom concentrated, where the total positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom, almost all the mass of the atom concentrated. Is called nucleus. So according to Bohr, if take one atom, so there is a core of the atom or central part of the atom where the 100% of the positive charge and also more than 99% of the mass of the atom, so concentrated at the central part only. So this central part only we are calling as nucleus. So Rutherford given and Bohr also saying the same thing. So the central part of the atom where the total positive charge and almost all the mass of the atom concentrated is called nucleus. So first point we can say about the nucleus. And the second point, what about electrons? So electrons are revolving in the circular orbits, but one electron cannot revolve in all the orbits and one electron cannot radiate energy continuously. So electrons can only revolve in those orbits for a condition given, in which the angular momentum of electron must be equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi. Here m is equal to mass of electron, v speed of electron, r radius of the circular orbit. So if you multiply all these three letters, we got angular momentum. Whenever angular momentum of electron is equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi, for example, electron revolving in the 10th orbit, then mass of electron into velocity of electron in the 10th orbit into radius of the 10th orbit. If you multiply, if it is equal to 10 into h by 2 pi, then electron can revolve only in the 10th orbit. So electrons can only revolve in those circular orbits in which the angular momentum of electron must be equal to integral multiples of h by 2 pi. So this is called Bohr's second postulate. So we can write second postulate. Electrons can revolve only in those orbits in which its angular momentum is equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi. Angular momentum is equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi. Angular momentum is equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi. And I'll write the formula here. If m is the mass of electron, e is equal to charge of electron, and v is equal to speed of electron, then we can write angular momentum of electron, L is equal to formula mvr, where m is equal to mass of electron, v velocity of electron, r radius of the circular orbit. But they are saying here angular momentum of electron in the given circular orbit must be equal to the integral multiples means n into h by 2 pi. Mvr is equal to nh by 2 pi, you should write, where n is equal to integer, positive integer 1 comma 2 comma 3 and so on you should write, which is also called as a principal quantum number. N is integer, which is called a principal quantum number. Principal quantum number. So we can take this values up to 1 comma 2 comma 3 comma 4 and so on, infinity we can write, up to infinity values you can take. And h already we know, Planck's constant. H is equal to Planck's constant. We know the value of Planck's constant, 6.62 into 10 power minus 34 joule second. Pi already constant only. M is equal to mass of electron. M is mass of electron. V is equal to magnitude of the velocity, that is the speed of electron. And R, radius of the circular orbit where the electron is revolving. Radius of the circular orbit. For example, if electron is revolving in the first orbit, then you should put here n is equal to 1. Then mvr is equal to h by 2 pi, angular momentum. If electron revolving in the second orbit, that is called 2h by 2 pi, we can write. So for example, when an electron is revolving in the first orbit of an atom, then we can write angular momentum, L1 is equal to 1 into h by 2 pi, which is equal to h by 2 pi, we can write. If a same electron revolving in the second orbit of a hydrogen atom, N is equal to, we should put 2. Then we can write second orbit L2 is equal to 2h by 2 pi. Should write 2h by 2 pi. Third orbit given 3h by 2 pi. Fourth orbit 4h by 2 pi. Nth orbit nh by 2 pi. For example, what is the difference of angular momentum between the first and second orbits? What is the difference of angular momentum in the first and second orbits? Means that delta L is equal to, I'll subtract L2 minus L1. So difference asked question, for example, in the complete exams, you have to subtract both. L2 is equal to 2h by 2 pi. Minus L1 is equal to h by 2 pi. You may take a h by 2 pi common. If you write h by 2 pi common, then it is equal to 2 minus 1. It is equal to 2 minus 1, which is equal to 1. Therefore, h by 2 pi, it is equal to the difference of angular momentum of electron in the first and second orbits. So sometimes, what is the difference of angular momentum of electron in the nth orbit and n plus 1 orbit? Nth orbit means first orbit, for example, and n plus 1 means 1 plus 1, second orbit. We can write the same formula, delta L is equal to angular momentum of electron in the n plus 1 orbit minus angular momentum of electron in the nth orbit, which is equal to n plus 1 orbit means we should write n plus 1 into h by 2 pi, should write n plus 1 into h by 2 pi minus nth orbit means nh by 2 pi, you should write. Here also h by 2 pi common. If take a h by 2 pi common, remaining n plus 1 minus n plus n get cancelled. Therefore, 1 into h by 2 pi is equal to h by 2 pi. So depending upon the question, we have to calculate. So that is the second postulate. So according to Bohr's second postulate, the electrons can only revolve in those orbits in which the angular momentum of electron is equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi. So Bohr's second postulate is also called Bohr's quantization condition of angular momentum. So this is also known as Bohr's quantization condition. Bohr's quantization condition of angular momentum. Bohr's quantization condition of angular momentum. Bohr's quantization condition of angular momentum. So sometimes for here the word quantization indicates it is electron orbits are always existed only integral multiples. 1 into h by 2 pi, 2 into h by 2 pi, 3 into h by 2 pi, 10 into h by 2 pi, n into h by 2 pi. But a fraction is not possible. So electron cannot revolve in the 1.5 into h by 2 pi, 0.7 into h by 2 pi not possible, 20.2 into h by 2 pi not possible. Only this n will be always 1, 2, 3, 4 integral multiples, 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. That's why that is called a quantization. So electron orbits are always quantized according to Bohr's second postulate. Hence, second postulate also called as Bohr's quantization condition of angular momentum. That is a second postulate. Now we'll go for a third postulate. What is a Bohr's third postulate? So according to generally Rutherford, electron can radiate energy continuously when it is moving in the circular orbit. But Bohr opposed that point. So electron can not always emitting energy. As long as electron is revolving around the nucleus, no energy was radiated by the electron or no energy emitted by electron. For example, electron is revolving in the first orbit of an atom like this. Until and unless the electron having acceleration, for example, electron moving with a speed of 10 meter per second. So any time electron is revolving, for example, 1 hour or 2 hours or 1 day or 1 year, whatever, doesn't matter. So as long as electron is revolving in this orbit, no energy was radiated, no energy was emitted by electron. So that's why the orbit is called as a stationary orbit. So stationary orbit concept given by Bohr. So that one more important point, a stationary orbit doesn't mean electron is a stationary. Electron is not at rest. Electron is revolving around the nucleus. But as long as electron is revolving around the nucleus, no energy was released or radiated by electron. Hence the orbit called as stationary orbit or non-radiating orbit. We can write a third postulate. As long as electron is revolving, as long as an electron is revolving in an orbit, no energy was radiated. No energy was radiated. Hence, these orbits are called stationary orbits or non-radiating orbits. That is a third point. So from Bohr's third postulate, we can understand one thing. Whenever electron is revolving in a particular orbit, no energy released by electron. That is clear. And fourth one, but here we may have one question. Whenever electron is revolving in a particular orbit, energy was not released. But when energy released by electron, that's a question mark. So that's also Bohr explained. Whenever electron jumps from the higher orbit to lower orbit, energy released by electron. Whenever electron revolving in the particular orbit, when we are supplying some amount of energy from outside, the electron will absorb and then electron may jump from the lower to higher orbit. So that's why when electron jumps from the higher stationary orbit to the lower stationary orbit, then only energy was released by electron. So that's important. So we can write here, I'll select two orbits. These are the two stationary orbits I'm choosing. Electron is revolving like this. It is a first stationary orbit and one is second stationary orbit. I'll consider one is equal to orbit is equal number n1, and the second orbit is equal, I'll take n2. Principal quantum number is equal n1. Here it is equal to quantum number is equal to n2, I'll take. Or we take n is equal to 1, here n is equal to 2, first orbit and second orbit. For example, one electron is revolving in the second orbit of an atom like this. It is a path of electron where it is revolving. So whenever electron is revolving in the second orbit, no energy was radiated by electron. Suddenly, when electron jumps from this second orbit to first orbit, then what will be happen? Energy released by electron. Whenever electron jumps from the higher orbit to lower orbit, energy is released by electron. If lower orbit corresponding to energy E1, n is equal to 1, energy equal E1, n is equal to 2, and energy is equal, I'll take E2. When electron jumps from this N2 orbit to next N1 orbit, what will be happen? Energy released by electron. What is amount of energy released means E is equal to E higher orbit minus E lower orbit, is right. E higher orbit minus E lower orbit. So that is equal to, we know one formula, E is equal to H nu. Your choice. For example, it is equal to, if you consider it is equal to N1 lower orbit. It is equal to, if you consider higher orbit, is equal to N2. I'll write here energy as EL lower orbit. EH is equal to E higher orbit also we can write. In place of the 1 and 2, your choice. We can write E higher orbit minus E lower orbit, which is equal to EH minus EL. Take this H right side. We can write a frequency of the radiation emitted by electron is equal to E higher orbit minus E lower orbit by H, you should write. So which is equal to frequency of radiation emitted by electron. So that is a fourth postulate. So what we can say? When electron is revolving in an orbit, no energy was emitted. When electron jumps from the higher stationary orbit to the lower stationary orbit, then only electron is released by electron. So we can write, note down this fourth postulate. When an electron jumps from, higher stationary orbit to, when an electron jumps from higher stationary orbit to a lower stationary orbit, when an electron jumps from higher stationary orbit to the lower stationary orbit, it radiates energy, or it releases, also right, it radiates energy. It radiates energy in the form of, it radiates energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation. Radiates energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation. Electromagnetic radiation. We can write here. Next point, right? When an electron jumps from N2 stationary orbit to, electron jumps from N2 stationary orbit to N1 stationary orbit. Electron jumps from N2 stationary orbit to N1 stationary orbit. N2 stationary orbit to N1 stationary orbit. The energy radiated. Note down this formula. E is equal to EH minus EL. Here EH means E higher orbit minus E lower orbit. Means E is equal to EH minus EL. But here E is equal to, we know the formula, H nu. E is equal to H nu. That equal EH minus EL. EH minus EL. Take H right side. Nu is equal to EH minus EL by H. So the nu is nothing but frequency. Frequency. It is a frequency of electromagnetic radiation emitted by electron. So this condition is also called Bohr's frequency condition. So already mentioned the second condition is called Bohr's second postulate, called as Bohr's angular momentum condition or quantization condition of angular momentum. But this fourth postulate called Bohr's frequency condition. This is known as Bohr's frequency condition. Bohr's frequency condition. Your choice. From this you may calculate lambda also. We know nu is equal to C by lambda. Nu is equal to C by lambda means we take lambda is equal to HC by EH minus E1 also we calculate. So in this formula, nu is equal to c by lambda is equal to e higher orbit minus e lower orbit divided by h should write. Therefore, lambda is equal to hc by e h minus e l. H indicates here higher orbit minus l is equal to lower orbit. It is a wavelength of radiation emitted by electron when it jumps from the higher orbit to lower orbit. You should take it. It is a frequency formula. It is a formula for wavelength. But one more point also write. These are the main postulates given by Bohr. But one more postulate also, if you want, you can write. Already Rutherford also given the same concept. When an electron revolving around the nucleus, which force is necessary? Centripetal force. But who will provide the centripetal force? Electrostatic force between the nucleus and the electron. So we can write a fifth point. For circular motion of electrons, for the circular motion of electrons, for the circular motion of electrons around the nucleus, for the circular motion of electrons around the nucleus, the necessary centripetal force, the necessary centripetal force is provided by necessary centripetal force is provided by the electrostatic force provided by the electrostatic force between the nucleus and electron. Electrostatic force between the nucleus and electron. So we can write centripetal force is equal to centripetal force is equal to electrostatic force between the nucleus and electron. We can write like this. Electrostatic force of attraction. But already we know centripetal force formula mv square by r. mv square by r is equal to electrostatic force already mentioned 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is a constant into q1 is equal to charge of the nucleus, Q2 is equal to charge of electron by distance equal to R. Should write R square, Coulomb's inverse square law. Or we can write MV square by R is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 is equal to ZE and Q2 is equal to E, charge of electron by R square, which is equal to ZE square by 4 pi epsilon naught into r square is equal to mv square by r. You should write, but your choice. If you want to make cancel r on both sides, you may write only r, also may take left side, that you call mv square into r is equal to ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught. So we can write like this also. It is a one important formula. Or you may stop after here also. Okay, your choice. Mv square by r is equal to ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught into r. These are the important 5 postulates given by Bohr. One of the important 5 marks question, this one. So the question may be asked, state and explain Bohr's postulates. Sometimes a 3 marks question or sometimes a 5 marks question. So important 5 points you should write. So we can write 1 point. The central part of the atom where the total positive charge and the mass of the atom concentrated is called nucleus. And the second point, electrons can only revolve in those orbits in which the angular momentum of electron is equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi. So that is also called Bohr's quantization condition of angular momentum. So third postulate, as long as electron is revolving around the nucleus, no energy was radiated by the electron. Hence those orbits are called stationary orbits or non-radiation orbits or non-radiating orbits. Fourth one, when an electron jumps from higher stationary orbit to the lower stationary orbit, then only energy is released by electron in the form of electromagnetic radiation, we can write the formula E is equal to E higher orbit minus E lower orbit, or E is equal to H nu. We can write nu is equal to E higher minus E lower by H. That is called Bohr's frequency condition of angular momentum. Similarly, for circular motion of electrons around the nucleus, so centripetal force is required. So this centripetal force is provided by the electrostatic force of attraction between the nucleus and electron. So these are five postulates given by Bohr. By using all these five postulates, we can derive the formula for radius of the circular orbit, velocity of electron, and also kinetic energy, potential energy, and also total energy of electron in the given stationary orbit. So there are also important five mass questions. So one derivation I'll give. First one, radius of nth stationary orbit. Understand carefully. In the Rutherford model, there is no stationary word, but in Bohr's model, stationary word is there. Important stationary orbit. So radius of nth stationary orbit of an atom. But one more important point you have to remember: Bohr primarily proposed the model only for hydrogen and hydrogen-like atoms. So not for all the atoms. He given the concept for hydrogen atom and also hydrogen-like atoms. What is a hydrogen atom means? Which contains only single electron. But what are hydrogen-like atoms? Hydrogen-like atoms. Sometimes they may ask us 2 marks question. What are hydrogen-like atoms? Give an example. Any nucleus or any atom which contains only single electron can be called as a hydrogen atom. So generally, if take a singly ionized helium (He+), it contains only one electron. That's what is called hydrogen-like atom. Or doubly ionized lithium (Li++) also contain only one electron. So we can call as hydrogen-like atom. And also 10 times ionized sodium atom, which is equal to 10+, if write for example. So that is called also called as nothing but hydrogen-like atom. So Bohr's model is applicable to hydrogen and also hydrogen-like atoms. That's important. Now, so put the heading radius of nth stationary orbit of an atom. Radius of nth stationary orbit of an atom. So diagram also much not necessary. We'll take only hydrogen atom or any atom you may take. It is equal to the nucleus, and the charge of this nucleus is equal to Ze, and one electron of mass m and the charge e is revolving in a nth stationary orbit. Radius of this orbit is equal to r, and the nth stationary orbit means the principal quantum number n, and the speed of electron is equal to v. So the simple diagram. So consider an electron of mass m, charge e is revolving around the circular nth stationary orbit of an atom. So here E is equal to charge of electron, Ze is equal to charge of the nucleus. But according to Bohr's model, which force is required here? Centripetal. The necessary centripetal force is provided by electrostatic force between the electron and the nucleus. Same formula you should write. You may copy this one. Now centripetal force is equal to mv square by r, is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 Q2 by R square you should write. But Q1 is equal to charge of the nucleus, that is called Ze. And Q2 is equal to charge of the electron, right? It is equal to E. We have to substitute here. Therefore, mv square by R is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q1 place him right Ze, and Q2 place him right E by R square. Therefore, mv square by R is equal to Ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught into R square. One RR get cancelled. Therefore, mv square into R is equal to Ze square by 4 pi epsilon naught. Equation 1. But already we have given Bohr's second postulate. So we can write here from Bohr's second postulate. From Bohr's second postulate. So I have given the formula. Angular momentum of electron in the nth orbit is equal to the integral multiples of h by 2 pi you should write. MVR is equal to NH by 2 pi. Now square this equation on both sides. By squaring on both sides, you'll get M square V square into R square is equal to N square H square by 2 pi whole square is equal to 4 pi square, equation 2. So we want to derive the formula for radius of the nth stationary orbit. Divide second equation with the first equation. We'll get the required value. Now I'll divide second equation with the first equation. Dividing a second equation with the first equation, we get. So second equation left side, I'm writing M square V square into R square divided by left side of the first equation M V square into R should write. That equal to M V square into R. And the right side of the second equation, we should write N square H square by 4 pi square. Similarly, second equation right side, if you write Z square by 4 pi epsilon naught, I'll write into. That equal to 4 pi epsilon naught. 4 pi epsilon naught by Z square. If any cancellation is there, so cancel the terms. Here, V square get cancelled. One R get cancelled, one M square, M also cancelled. So left side we have only M into R. But right side, one pi, pi get cancelled, 4 also cancelled. Then remaining is equal to N square H square into epsilon naught by, it is equal to pi into Z square. But our aim is to find the expression for radius of the stationary orbit. Take M right side by keeping a letter R left side only. R is equal to N square H square into epsilon naught by pi M into Z square. So it is a final expression for the radius of nth stationary orbit of any atom. So particularly if they asked a hydrogen atom, substitute Z is equal to 1. In place of the Z, if you put 1, then you get the formula R is equal to N square H square into epsilon naught by pi M into E square. That is the formula. So it is one of the important 5 marks question for PUC level. So practice the formula carefully. And the last, you only write one more step. Radius of the nth stationary orbit of hydrogen atom. Just to put N is equal to 1 and write the formula. In tomorrow class, we'll discuss the velocity and the total energy of electron. Okay, thank you. Mm.